All right, so let's pray real quick. Dear Lord, thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to come to men's preaching class, Lord, and just practice preaching your word, Lord. I pray that after all the preparation, Lord, I pray that this would just come to fruition and be beneficial for everyone here. And I pray that you would just be with me, Lord. Let me preach in the spirit. Let all things that I say be true. I pray that it will glorify you and edify us. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to go to Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1. And I'm going to focus on the first two verses of the book of Hebrews. Now, Hebrews is full of a lot of doctrine. Hebrews is personally one of my favorite books in the Bible. I love the book of Hebrews because Hebrews is very deep doctrinally. And every time you read Hebrews, you learn something new. That could be said for all of the Bible, but Hebrews specifically, it's just an incredibly deep book. We're going to start in Hebrews chapter 1, and the title of my sermon is going to be The God of the Old Testament. The God of the Old Testament. Now, the God of the Old Testament a lot of times gets a bad rap. A lot of people say negative things about God in the Old Testament. And they'll say things that he's mean, you know, that he's that he hates too much, that he's, you know, overly aggressive, that he's not sympathetic, you know. But I want to preach about the God of the Old Testament and just prove that the God of the Old Testament is the same God of the New Testament. Amen. Hebrews chapter 1 says, God who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Now the Bible says God there is the Father. And you can prove that by verse 2. It says, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. So the first thing I want to explain is that God the Father in the Old Testament, you could say here, if we're just going to divide this, in the Old Testament, he communicated to the nation of Israel by the holy prophets. And now in these last days, he speaks to us by his Son. One easy application of this, I don't believe this is the primary application of this, but one easy application is when you go soul winning, you talk to somebody and they're about to call upon the name of the Lord, and you say, you know, hey, how do we talk to God? Even an unsaved person understands that we talk to God by praying. Well, how does God talk to us? He talks to us through the Word of God, right? If you want to talk to God, you pray. If you want to hear God talk to you, you read. Amen. Well, the Bible says that in the last days he's spoken to us by his Son. And it says that there was a change there in what took place. Now, the reason that I kind of decided to preach on this is because I was asked a hard question. And I'll admit it's a hard question. And it's about an Old Testament appearance of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now turn with me to Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18. This is a very famous passage. A lot of people, you know, I believe that the Orthodox Trinity, the sermon is not about the Orthodox Trinity, but I believe the Orthodox Trinity is derived from people misunderstanding Old Testament appearances of Christ. Yeah. I want to say this real quick, that there is only one image of God. Amen. When we get to heaven, you only see one image. He's always been that image. And you can prove that by Genesis chapter 1, where it says, let us make man in our image. The next verse it says, so God made man in his own image. So Genesis chapter 1 teaches you that there is an image of God. Now, if you look at Genesis chapter 18, read verses 1, it says, and the Lord appeared unto him in the plains of Mamre, and he sat at the tent door in the heat of the day, and he lifted up his eyes and looked, and lo, three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself toward the ground and said, my Lord, if now I have found favor in thy sight, pass not away, I pray thee, from thy servant. Let a little water, I pray you, be fetched, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. And I will fetch a morsel of bread, and comfort ye your hearts. After that ye shall pass on. For therefore are ye come to your servant. And they said, so do as thou hast said. And notice this, and Abraham hastened into the tent unto Sarah, and said, make ready quickly three measures of fine meal, knead it, and make cakes upon the earth. Now I want to point out that it says that Abraham hastened. Well, also notice this, that the Lord appears unto him in the plains of Mamre, while he sat at the tent door, and he lifted up his eyes and looked, and lo, three men stood by him, and when he saw them, he ran to meet them. I believe Abraham knew who this was, and actually Jesus, I believe, references this in John chapter 8. He says, when he's talking to the Jews, he said that Abraham, I'm going to read it for you because I don't want to misquote it. It says that, I believe it's a dual application, but I believe it's relevant here. It says in John chapter 8, verse number, let me see. It says in John chapter 8, verse number, It says, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad, right? I believe Abraham saw the Lord. He knew who he was, and I believe that he was glad when he saw the Lord, right? I'd be glad if I saw the Lord. Amen. Well, I was asked a hard question. Who did Abraham see? Because we don't believe that God is three different persons. We don't believe he's eternally always been three different persons. And this is a hard question because before the Son of God was born on this earth, who did he see? Well, I believe he saw the image of the invisible God, right? Now, I want to notice one thing real quick. It says in Genesis chapter 17, in verse number 1, it says in the same way, it says, "In when Abraham was 90 years old and 9, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God, walk before me and be thou perfect." So it says it in the same way that the Lord appeared unto Abraham. I don't believe this is any different. That's just my own personal, that's just what I gather from this. But I also want to point out something else. It says in verse 1, it says in verse number 7, it says, "And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed after thee, and their generations for an everlasting covenant." Now, the Lord is standing before Abraham. Abraham's looking at the Lord, I believe, and he says, "I'm going to make a covenant with you." And notice what he says in the latter half of that verse. He says, "To be a God unto thee, into thy seed after thee." So the Lord stands there and he says, "I'm going to be your God and I'm going to be your seed's God." Now, if you compare scripture with scripture, which is what we're supposed to do, Galatians chapter 3, which is where we're going to turn, tells you exactly who the seed is. But I want to point out one thing real quick. You know, I'll show you that this cannot be the second person of the Trinity, because in Hebrews chapter number 6, it says this. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13, "For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself." So therefore, we can conclude that this is not the second person of the Trinity, because there is no greater than the Lord, right? But the second person of the Trinity has one greater, right? And they would reference, "My Father is greater than all," right? "And no man can pluck you out of my Father's hand." Well, the Bible says that that God promised unto Abraham, and because he could promise by no greater, he promised, you know, he swore by himself. You know, so, you know, just to point out in verse number 19, it says, in Genesis chapter 18, verse 19, it says, "And God said, Sarah thy wife shall bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant and with his seed after him." Now go to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, and we're going to see who this seed is. I think everybody knows who the seed is, except for maybe my son sitting here. He might not know. It says in Galatians chapter 3, we're going to focus on verse number 16 through 19. It says, "Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not into seeds as of many, but as of one, into thy seed, which is Christ." So we know that the seed is Christ. "And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law which was 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of none effect. For if the inheritance," notice this, "be of the law, is it no more of promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise. Wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come, to whom the promise was made." So the seed was not there at this moment, but the promise was made, right? Now I'm going to read this from Romans chapter number 1. Romans chapter number 1, it's kind of like a parallel passage to Hebrews chapter 1. It says, "Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ," in verse number 1, "called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh." So that seed that was to come was Christ the Lord, right? Now, you know, real quick before I get ahead of myself, you should be in Galatians chapter 3. It says in Galatians chapter 3, verse number 22, it says, "But the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe." Now, in the Old Testament, we're not dispensationalists. We believe that salvation was by faith, right? We believe salvation was the promise that he had promised us, even eternal life. We still believe it was a free gift. You know, we reject any kind of dispensationalism here. But the seed has always been the promise, right? And salvation was always through that seed. Right. But this is when the seed physically came. Right. This is when the child was born. Now, You know, Abraham tells the Lord, I think it's Genesis chapter 15, he tells the Lord, you know, I need an heir, right? The only person in my house is Eliezer. And he says, you know, Sarah's going to have a child. He's going to be your seed. He's going to be the heir. Well, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 1, whom he hath appointed heir of all things. Now, when Jesus Christ, he says in John chapter 3, I'm going to read it real quick. He says, the Father hath given everything into his hand, right? I'm misquoting that. Father loveth the Son and hath given all things into his hand. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the inheritor. That's how we, by Christ, by being in Christ, inherit. But real quick, I want to just point out one thing real quick. A major, you know, misunderstanding of kind of like this doctrine is verses like Revelation chapter 1. And I was just reading my Bible a couple weeks ago, maybe a couple days ago, it wasn't a week ago. And I noticed this. It says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Now I'm going to bounce this verse off of Revelation chapter 5 and I'm going to prove all things. It says, and they sung a new song saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. And notice this, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. So who made us kings and priests unto our God? Christ, right? Now this is the danger. If you say that Jesus Christ is not that God, you're saying that he's just the seed. You're saying that he's just a prophet to come. You're saying he's just an apostle. But he's more than that. He's the God of the Old Testament. That's what Hebrews chapter 1 is all about. Now, real quick, I want to focus and I want to make my closing point. Hebrews chapter 1 says, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Now, I want to make this plain. The Father spake unto the fathers by the prophets. The Son speaks unto us now. You know, I find it interesting that Christians will come to us and they accuse us of not believing in the deity of Christ, but I can point to a verse in the Bible that has the word God in it, referring to God in heaven. And these Christians will say, that's not Jesus. That's a real big problem.
Amen.
Jesus is the God of the Old Testament,
Amen.
Right? And I'm going to explain that in just one second. But according to Hebrews chapter 1, if it's the Father speaking unto the fathers by the prophets, then I should never find Jesus talking in the book of Isaiah.
Right.
Right? So let's go to Isaiah real quick. I'm going to read one verse. You don't have to go there. I'm just going to read it. It says in Isaiah chapter 43, and everybody knows who's talking. Isaiah 43:10, you're my witnesses, saith the Lord, my servant whom I have chosen, that ye may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I, even I, am the Lord, and beside me there's no Savior. It's not I, and then someone else is like, even I. Right? It's I, even I, am the Lord, and beside me there's no Savior. The Bible, it says, I have declared and have saved and have showed, and there was no strange God among you. Therefore, ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God. Notice this. I am the Lord, verse 15, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. You know, a lot of people say the Holy One is just the second person of the Trinity. The Holy One is the Creator of Israel,
Amen.
Right? The Holy One is the Lord of hosts. And Acts chapter 2 or Acts chapter 3 tells you that Jesus Christ is the Holy One. He tells the Jews, you've rejected the Holy One. Zechariah 12:10, then I'm going to be done. It says in Zechariah 12:10, it says, again, you know, if this is Jesus talking, which it's abundantly clear that it is, then the Orthodox Trinity has a real major problem. It says, and I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. Right. So let me ask you, according to Hebrews chapter 1, who's talking right now?
Father.
It's God the Father. It doesn't matter how you interpret it. There's no other interpretation you can take thereof. You know what else it proves? It proves the Son is referring to the seed that was to come, right? The Father's talking here, and that's why the God of the Old Testament is the same God of the New Testament.
Amen.
The Bible says in Isaiah 9:6, it says, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. The only time in the Old Testament the term Father is used referring to God, you know who it's talking about? The Son that was given. the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the God of the Old Testament. He was born on this earth, and he, you know, I want to read this last verse, and this is it. Hebrews 12:2, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, right? Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. A lot of people say, well, how is he sitting at the right hand, right? Well, the Bible says he's the author and finisher. Amen. Right? He's the beginning and the end. That, you know, the Lord Jesus Christ is sitting at the right hand. You're going to look upon him whom they have pierced, right? And you're going to know that your Savior, that your Lord did it himself. He's the author and finisher. God don't ever ask you to do something that he wouldn't do himself. He never ask you to, you know, to turn the other cheek if he wouldn't do it himself. He never ask you to, you know, pick up your cross if he wasn't willing to do it himself. And he would never ask you to lay down your life if he didn't, if he wasn't willing to do it himself. The God of the Old Testament, Lord Jesus Christ, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, just for your word, dear Lord. I pray that it was just beneficial for anyone and everyone here, Lord. I'm just thankful for the opportunity, Lord. I'm thankful for the King James Bible and just the ability to learn, Lord. Just your wisdom. I pray that you would just continue to bless us, Lord. Make me a better preacher and be with the church. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen.